So thank you very much for giving me this opportunity, and thanks a lot, Dr. Sendhil and Professor Srinivasan sir, for your nice words. I do not know whether I am eligible for those nice words. I am trying to do whatever I have learned from our Professor Srinivasan and our mentors like Professor Gopal, Professor Jayam, Professor Pushpa, and Professor Namalwar. We are just trying to do something which they have done throughout their lifetime. So now coming to the topic, abdominal pain in office practice is a really difficult position, difficult presentation for any one of us to do. That is like deciphering a Pablo Picasso's picture. We do not know what is in the picture. Someone will interpret something and someone will tell this is this, this is that. We do not know. But unlike Pablo Picasso's picture, we may have something in abdomen. So my aim of this today's meeting presentation is, after our shared learning and active participation from all of you, we will be able to see the Pandora's box. This Pandora's box, as per Greek mythology, is being given by Zeus to Pandora, the first female, and is being told not to open. Like any person who is being told not to open, she opened, and we have this world with all the problems. Is it a real Pandora box, the abdomen? We will see. So with this short introduction, we will try to find out what is the foci of pain, whether it is an intestinal or an extra intestinal, why there is a pain, will it resolve shortly or will it take time, any investigations are needed for to find out the cause, and how to manage. To manage abdominal pain in a child is really complex. It needs a clinician par excellence, usually the pediatrician. Actually, he's a part craftsman, part practical scientist, and part historian. We are going to find out whether this lesion is any problem causing this pain is a benign one, or it is life-threatening. What organ is affected? Is it from the visceral or from the parietal pain? Does it need a short course or will it last long? Now we will see the visceral abdominal pain, which will be deep, dull, diffuse. Usually the three general localizations of midline abdominal pain are: one, epigastric; two, periumbilical; three is a hypogastric. Epigastric regional pain usually suggests that this is of the thorax, stomach and duodenum, pancreas, liver and GB. Periumbilical pain usually implies disease of the small intestine, cecum or both. Hypogastric pain usually implicates large intestine, pelvic organs, urinary systems. This pain happens because of stretching, tension, the capsule of solid organs or mesentery. It is caused usually by infections, toxins, ulceration, inflammation, ischemia, and congestion. The parietal pain receptors are stimulated by direct contiguous stimulation of the nearby organs, innervated by specific dorsal root ganglion. It is increased by movement, cough. It is an intense localized pain. For example, if you have a right iliac fossa pain, it could be due to an appendix, or could be acute Crohn's disease, or could be due to a ectopic rupture or a pelvic inflammatory disease, or it could be acute pancreatitis and pseudocyst, or it could be a incarcerated inguinal hernia or a Meckel's diverticulitis. The reason could be from any of the causes. We need to do some test to find out the reason for the problem. We have got three tests which will tell you few ideas, which will give us few ideas. The first one is the Carnot test, which will be on the abdominal musculature. Let the child lie supine and let the child just try to get up by lifting head or shoulder. The pain is same or it is increasing, it is intra, it is extra abdominal or abdominal muscle pain. Then this is an obturator test, is pain occurs when the hip is flexed and internally rotated. Yes, a cause of pelvic or retroperitoneal disease or both. In case of a Sawyer sign, the test may be performed actively or passively. The hip is passively extended, the stretching the psoas muscle. The hip is actively flexed using against resistance, thus tensing the psoas muscle. So we will have the psoas test positive when there is a retrocecal appendix or a psoas abscess or any other abscess or pus collection near the psoas muscle. Before you jump into any diagnosis, we need to ask about the pain. So the pain, you need to ask, that's very, very important. This is, ask the child or the parent to point out the site of maximum pain. Ask them, check whether their favorite activity is affected. If the movement increases the pain, whether the pain stays in one place localized or it is radiating to other places. Ask whether it is migratory. If it is migratory, then usually it may not be much problematic. Ask if there is any change in intensity over a period of time. Ask about the same kind of pain or a problem in other family members. Probably if it is a food poisoning, most of the mothers will tell you, sir, the pain is there, probably food poisoning. And when you ask anyone in the family is having a problem, they will tell no one else. So it may not be the food poisoning. And ask about the playmates and classmates' history, whether they have a same issue like any problem. Recently, they had a viral infection, diarrhea, or some other issues. And just check from the parents whether there is any systemic or inherited disease like diabetes mellitus in a known child, or a celiac disease in a child having this problem, whether having a sickle cell anemia or porphyria like. There are humpty number of conditions which can cause abdominal pain. They don't come very often. They're all very rare causes. But try to ask family history of migraine in the either parent and ask for any previous episodes, whether the parent, whether the child had the same kind of episode, any previous surgery, trauma, and when you examine the child, look out for a scars and ask for any associated symptoms. The symptoms which help are anorexia. Obviously, a pain which is involving the gastrointestinal system will definitely affect the appetite. So anorexia is an important symptom which we should not forget to ask. Then ask about the nausea and vomiting. There is always the difficulty in differentiating acute gastroenteritis with an acute surgical problem in the very early stage. Pain preceding vomiting, it is acute surgical. Vomiting preceding pain, it is acute gastrointestinal infection. And if the child vomits, see the color of the vomitus. If it is bilious, probably upper GI obstruction or some infection. If it is a dark green or a feculent, lower GI obstruction. If it is a brown or blood stain, it could be a gastritis or a peptic ulcer. Diarrhea could be caused by intestinal infection or extra intestinal infection. If it is an intestinal infection caused by a small intestinal pathogen, the volume will be very large. Ask about the volume and they will have a crampy pain relieved by passing motion. If it is small volume, frequent, probably it is a large bowel diarrhea or it is due to extra intestinal irritation by caused by the inflammation. We should ask for the triggering and relieving factors. Whether meals reduces, spices increases the pain, probably a peptic ulcer pain. specific foods include are a pain, bloating, probably lactose, or some sucrose deficiency, we may ask for that. Then pain relieved by defecation is due to constipation. Pain worsened by defecation, probably in colitis. Always check the bowel movements and stool appearance. The stool frequency and consistency will tell you whether the child has got diarrhea or a constipation. If there is an urgency or a nocturnal diarrhea, probably colitis. Bloating, flatulence, probably in carbohydrate malabsorption. And if they taken food outside, probably it's a giardiasis. If there is a bleeding PR, probably look out for a fissure in ano, hemorrhoid, polyp, colitis, HSP. Recurrent jelly is very late presentation of intussusception. We have to pick up the case early than waiting for the recurrent jelly. Melina always denotes there is an upper GI bleed, whether it could be due to problem or an ulcer or due to some drug NSAID. Pale stool will tell you whether it is a hepatic or a biliary cause causing this problem. So when the child comes around, you have to, before put your hand on the child, as soon as the child enters, see if the child is active running around, probably you are getting your fee-free, you may not need to work up. The child is ill, lethargic, rolls over, definitely there is some issue. The child is looking alert, but lying still, relentless examination, there may be some peritonitis. So to find out all this, remove clothing for good exposure of abdomen, we have to examine in a relaxed, friendly manner, which is very difficult in a crying child. Probably we'll try to converse with the child about their family, friends, pets, online class, teachers. You can try to divert the attention of the child, but never lie or surprise. Don't tell them the child will not hurt. If you put your hand and press it, it hurts. Child will not forgive you. Don't do some surprise. Just like that, don't remove the undergarment. Absence of fever doesn't rule out surgical problem. Just remember that if there is no fever, doesn't mean it is not a surgical problem. It may be. If the child has got tachycardia, it could be due to anxiety of seeing us, or maybe due to pain, or it could be dehydration, fever, or shock. If there is tachypnea, breathing rate is more, could be a metabolic cause, could be if the child is very sick looking, could be in shock, DM, diabetes mellitus, or some condition. We have to examine the head, neck, chest, and extremities for a pharyngitis, tonsillitis, cervical adenitis, and chest for a lower lobe pneumonia and extremities, especially hip if there is an arthritis. These things might present like a abdominal pain. If you, when you see the abdomen, observe any distension is there. See, you will be able to observe any peristaltic waves, any inguinal masses, any scars, whether it's surgical or traumatic. When you go for the abdominal examination, do it, make the child as much comfortable as possible. Just find out where is the point of pain. Come to that area last. Gentleness is the key. Stethoscope is always good. It can be used for auscultation and palpation. In auscultation, you observe for the bowel sounds. In obstruction, it is high pitched. In active and loud in acute gastroenteritis, less or none in peritonitis. You can use the stethoscope as a palpation method by pressing the stethoscope head. Look for true tenderness and guarding. Afterwards, you can use a palpation, use your hands in parallel. When you palpate, always look at the child's face, whether child is having a pain or grimacing. See and note the location. As I said, the point of location has to be examined fully at the last. Child may have a guarding, which may be voluntary or involuntary. voluntary guarding may be due to apprehension or anxiety. You can ask the child to take a deep breath, or you can ask the child to keep the hip or limb flexed, or some other appropriate maneuvers. Involuntary guarding is to the involvement of the parietal peritoneum and reflex spasm of the abdominal muscle. Rebound tenderness is caused by inflamed foci. When compressed and released, there is a pain. It is a sign of peritoneal irritation. Sometimes you feel pediatric surgeons are a little bit too hard on children. They try to just push it, and I always feel that they are a little more, should have been more gentler in examining or eliciting rebound tenderness. But you can ask the child to cough or jump or stand on the tip of the feet. These things also will cause a rebound pain tenderness. So pain, rebound tenderness will be there. So these are also, can be taken as a sign of peritoneal irritation. Asking the child to cough, jump, or stand on tiptoe. Pain may be referred pain or radiating pain. There are some extra abdominal lesions which can cause the pain radiated referred to abdomen, like a lower lobe pneumonia, sick inflammatory disease. Extra peritoneal organs like a pancreas, kidney, ureter, great vessels, pelvic organs, retrose peritoneal space infections can also cause a referred abdominal pain. The pain may be from a primary site simultaneously perceived in a secondary site as a radiating pain. In case of a cholecystitis, it is radiating to the subscapular area. In a splenic injury, it radiates to the shoulder. In a ureteral colic, radiates to testis, upper leg and groin. In pancreatitis, it radiates to back. We need to remember, when you suspect a condition like a cholecystitis, splenic injury, ureteric stone, pancreatitis, try to see whether the pain is radiating to the secondary site. And when a child present with an acute abdominal pain, we have to see whether the child's pain probably from some extra abdominal lesion or extra peritoneal lesion. If the pain becomes sudden and excruciating, this is an important time we should work. Very fast. It could be an intestinal colitis, or could be a vascular occlusion in midgut, valvular, strangulator hernia, ovarian and testicular torsion, endocarditis or embolic, or it could be a luminal occlusion in urolithiasis, cholelithiasis or strangulator hernia, or it could be a true intra-abdominal hemorrhage in ruptured ectopic pregnancy or an aortic aneurysm or ruptured spleen. The red flag signs are, if the child is less than 4 years, localized pain in non-periumbilical area, and the pain is a referred pain, pain disturbing the sleep, sudden excruciating pain, crescendo pain, sudden worsening of pain, these are all real red flags we need to work up. Child presenting with pain, abdomen, fever and jaundice, and child with a distension abdomen, that could be 5F, fat, feces, flatus, fluid and fetus. And if the child is presenting with vomiting and some other specific signs like a hepatomegaly or a mass, these are all the some of the red flag signs we should be aware of. Now we will see few of the common things which we usually see. One is an infantile colic. It is usually useful, and any child coming with a less than 6 months of age coming with a pain, we always treat it as an infantile colic. It has got a place in now the latest functional gastrointestinal disorder Rome 4 classification. It affects up to 1/3 of children. The etiology may be multifactorial. One good thing is it is self-limiting, resolves by 4 months of age. So gentle low velocity, low amplitude manipulative techniques in chiropractice and other things might help, which we do not have it here. Maternal dietary manipulation, probiotics, non-prescription remedies may be of some benefit according to some studies. Meta-analysis of six RCTs shown lactobacillus reteri demonstrated overall positive effect, but no evidence to support the use of thymethicone, herbal agents, sugar, dicyclobine, or simetropium bromide. Recent Cochrane meta-analysis has shown no evidence to support use of any dietary intervention in practice. The rule of three in previously we thought about praying for more than 3 hours per day, for more than 3 days per week, for a period of 3 weeks or longer in other ways healthy infants. Now it has been age less than 5 months and past week cried or fussy for no reason, crying or fussy for 3 or more hours a day, crying or fussy for 3 days out of 7, 3 hours or more of unsuitable fussing crying yesterday and gaining weight normally. That is the one almost the same. The as we seen, the main treatment is now they tell you is a parent training program. It is to teach the parent soothing techniques, advice on feeding, normalization material in any form. Teaching format is face-to-face course, online learning, printed material, home visit, remote support and counseling. Without giving any medication, it seems crying times may be reduced among infants whose parents attend parent training program, but the certainty of the evidence is low. So the investigations which we try to use are we'll start with a common investigation. Like of the country, we always tell it is an iron deficiency, but if the anemia is for a long duration, probably we think about an inflammatory bowel disease, anemia with severe pain, Meckel's anemia with severe pain with a passing blood and mucus, blood or a brown or a black stool, probably an ulcer, chronic anemia in SLE and IBD. If there is a leukocytosis, probably there is an infection, blood dyscrasia, appendicitis, or any infection like abscess, infection, gangrene, perforation, peritonitis, or it could be due to pharyngitis, pneumonia, pyelonephritis, PID, and HUS. If there is a lymphocytosis, probably acute gastroenteritis, systemic illness, we have to think about. Urine examination plays an important role. High specific gravity with acetone positivity, it shows poor food intake and dehydration. Sugar positivity and acetone plus probably DKA, high pus cells plus bacteria, nitrate and leukocyte positivity, probably a UTI. If there is a hematuria, probably renal stone. Other investigations like serum electrolytes, amylase and lipase for pancreatitis, LFT and inflammatory markers for other conditions. X-rays might help. If you want, nowadays people don't advise to take X-ray except if you suspect intestinal obstruction. If you suspect in lower lobe pneumonia, you can ask them to take an X-ray chest and abdomen, which will cover both. Ultrasound abdomen is easily available and in one of the good modalities of investigation for us. So to come up now, we have got a small infant. The common causes are always asked when the child was fed. The child was fed very late, probably a hunger. Then extra intestinal infections like ASOM, pharyngitis, pneumonia, proper diet, probably a GRD. Or the child has got, a prodromal features of a gastroenteritis, acute gastroenteritis. Infantile colic, as I said, it is one of the differential diagnoses in infants. Very rare conditions are UTI, the child might have not grown well, and if it is there is a vomiting and associated symptoms, probably valveless intussusception, intestinal obstruction. And the constipation is the child has a change in the bowel frequency or bowel quantity. In an older child, commonest problem which we see now in acute pain abdomen, one of the common reason is the functional constipation or a constipation. Mesenteric adenitis and acute gastroenteritis prodromal phase, probably a UTI and functional gastrointestinal diseases. Other causes like extra intestinal causes, intestinal obstruction are very rare. Appendicitis comes down in the lower level only. GRD, gastritis, gallstones, hepatitis, all depending on the other associated features and conditions. And DKA, when you suspect the child comes with effortless tachypnea. Now we will see the few conditions. One is a mesenteric adenitis. Mesenteric adenitis is one of the commonest diagnosis is by ultrasound. We have a child presenting with a severe pain abdomen. We send the child to an ultrasound. The ultrasoundologist say it is a mesenteric adenitis, non-specific. So it is a radiological diagnosis. It may not be the cause of pain as per recent paper published from Israel. It usually occurs in the first decade. They may have a fever, vomiting, loose stools, and a viral prodrome. Sometimes they may not have also. They have a long duration of history. It could be due to primary or a secondary. Primary due to infection like Yersinia, which is very uncommon here. Non-typhoidal salmonellosis, enteric fever, infectious mononucleosis. Could be due to inflammation or malignancy. They might be attending the hospital multiple times. They have a low total count, high lymphocytes, negative CRP. In ultrasound, they'll say 3 or more nodes in ultrasound, more than 10 millimeter in short axis. Usually it happens in 64% of children of presenting with abdominal pain. It is a self-limiting inflammatory condition. The treatment is supportive care, hydration, pain medication. Unless until you decide it needs an antibiotic, there is no need. The thing is, we need to explain, reassure the parent, and recovery usually in 2 to 4 weeks time. Removal of fear and concerns is difficult to achieve in these patients. Appendix can present, may be located anteriorly, medially, or retrocecally due to the mobility of the bowels. So in many different appendicular pain, which is not in a normal place. The diagnosis of appendix and acute pancreatitis are very uncommon, but these are all the main things we are so worried about. So appendicitis is caused by luminal obstruction by fecolith, lymphoid hyperplasia, inflammation, rarely parasites. It could be a simple or could be a suppurative or gangrenous or ruptured or abscessed. In ultrasound, you will see a non-compressible appendix. If it is ruptured, it is not visualized. Nowadays, papers have come up about medical appendectomy using antibiotics, pain medication, and IV fluids, which is equivalent to surgical appendectomy without much post complications also, without much recurrence risk for surgery, and it has not gained momentum in our country. There are scores which are available to tell you which pain probably might need a medical appendectomy. Surgical appendectomy by laparoscopy or by conventional surgical procedure. Acute pancreatitis is due to obstruction of pancreatic duct, release and activation of pancreatic digestive enzymes, destruction and necrosis of pancreas. Probably commonest is a trauma. Next is an infection. Third is a drug, especially if the child is on a sodium valproate. Think about that. Then other things are very rare, like a biliary stones, multisystem disease, metabolic diseases like hypertriglyceridemia, if you have a close group of people in your care. Needs intensive care, good hydration and supportive care is what is needed. So common differential diagnoses are very few. are gastroenteritis, mesenteric adenitis, UTA, appendicitis, and psychogenic. Probably gastroenteritis, we'll all know they will have a diffuse pain, no localized pain, fever and diarrhea will be there. In mesenteric adenitis, they will have might have fever, abdominal pain, tenderness, and they will not have diarrhea. Urinary tract infection, they will have fever and localized pain, but diarrhea may be there. Appendicitis, they will definitely have abdominal tenderness, localized pain with fever. Other things, even a small little diarrhea might be present. Psychogenic, they may not have a fever, they may have a localized pain. And diffuse pain also may be there. So now we come to a final diagnosis and we'll come to the management. No specific findings, no tenderness, no distension with or without fever, vomiting, diarrhea. It could be viral induced. Give adequate hydration, oral fluids are retained, discharge home. If the patient is dehydrated, not retaining oral fluids, either you keep them for a daycare, rehydrate them, do bowel rest for 12 to 24 hours. If the child is fine, improving, you can discharge them. There is a point tenderness. There are diarrhea with the distension, bilious vomiting, peritoneal signs, bloody stools, palpable mass. Call the surgeon. Immediate surgical consult. And make sure the surgeon sees the baby at the earliest time and let the surgeon take the surgical treatment very early. If the features are uncertain, but child is ill, findings do not fit any specific diagnosis. Surgical consult, get it, admit, observe, nilpal, oral, no improvement, again call the surgeon and get the surgeon's opinion and closely follow up the child. The take-home messages are, observe the child, examine gently. Before doing all these things, you have to ask the history, which is very essential about the pain, everything concerned with the pain. Examine the child on the parent lap, distract if needed. Child, ask the child to point out site of pain. Nearer to umbilicus, it is farther away from organicus. Use sedatives or analgesics. Don't worry, it will not change your findings. It will definitely reduce the severe pain. Child will remember you for that. Rule out extra intestinal casts. Like an infection in the throat, pneumonia in the lungs, or a spinal issues, or arthritis in the hip. Remember mimics like a DKA, porphyria, sickle cell crisis. You may get it once in your lifetime, but you should not miss those things. Miserable, uncooperative patient, yes, it is a surgical cause. So thank you very much for giving me this opportunity. I am ready to take up the questions, if any, for us. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Selvan. You had brought out the abdominal pain features